on the complexity of torus knot reconciliation.
Thanks for giving the opportunity to speak here. Everything I'm going to talk about is joint work with John Waldman. So when I say on the complexity of it, I mean that this is not meant to be the final word on the situation, but this is sort of in line with recent efforts to certify that, that if you have a knot in the free script, that it's either the unknot or it isn't. So just some quick history. So it goes back to Hawken, who, around the time he invented normal surface theory, he proved that recognizing the unknot is a decidable question. And the way to do this is to say, well, if I have an unknot, then it's got a spanning surface, which is a disk. And so you triangulate the complement of the knot, and you just search for normal surfaces that might be a disk, and eventually you find one, and that's great. Or maybe you don't, and you get sort of outside the bounds of where, you know, where you expect such a disk to live. And so, fast forward about 30 years or so, then Hess, Ligarius, and Pippinger proved that it's actually not just decidable, but that if you have an unknot, that you can sort of recognize it relatively quickly. So let's write this as unknot is an NP. And the basic idea is basically the same. You triangulate the complement and you look for a spanning disk. And the part about being an NP means that rather than have an algorithm that identifies the unknot sort of proactively, I hand you a certificate that says this is an unknot, and it contains enough details that you can prove it. And not just, you know, in arbitrarily long time, but in time polynomial in the crossing number. And so basically what they did is they found bounds on the complexity of a normal disk that bounds that's bounded by the unknot. And since those bounds were exponential, you can specify the normal surface coordinates in polynomially many digits, and then just do some work to check that it was actually a disk. So this was done around 1999. And like I said, the idea in both cases is to triangulate the exterior and give normal surface coordinates for a disk. Hawken's algorithm was go ahead and just search all the possibilities until you find it, and the fact that the certificate is just here they are, you know, go ahead and check. That's detecting or maybe certifying that something is the unknot. How do you certify the opposite, that it's not it? And so about 2014, Greenberg gave a solution which is simultaneously very short and also very hard to check for the following reason. He proved that knottedness is in co-NP if we assume the generalized Riemann hypothesis. So that's the part that's hard to check.
Or you want to.
Oh, you're right. Knottedness is an NP. Unknot is a co-NP. It's NP. So if I give you a knot that's non-trivial, how do you certify that it's actually knotted? Let me just finish saying what the assumption was here. And so here's the idea of, you know, how the certificate works. Is I hand you a representation of the knot group, so pi 1 of the exterior, into SL2 over a finite field, Fp, where p is not too big. So by not too big, I mean that the log of p, the number of digits, is a polynomial in n, where n is the crossing number. And, okay, if I have a certificate like this, a representation, non-abelian image, then it's clearly not the unknot, because the unknot has a abelian group, and so any image of it is also going to be abelian. How do you know that such a representation always exists, though, if you have a non-trivial knot? You apply first a theorem of Kronheimer and Rivka from a few years before that, which says that if K is knotted, then there exists a representation of pi 1 of the exterior into SU2, which you can think of as sitting inside SL2C with not an abelian image. So that this is not an easy theorem, it requires some gauge theory to prove. But once you have that, then you say that the variety of, well, the set of representations inside, so representations from the knot group to SL2 over whatever field you'd like with non-abelian image, that this is actually an algebraic variety. And so if it has a complex point, then you can argue that it has to have a point over infinitely many finite fields. And in fact, you can take the field to be FP, where P is in some positive density set of primes. But that doesn't tell you that there's a small p, small in that sense there, where it has not too many digits. So it's not, this variety is not empty. It has FP points for lots of p. And then you have to hit it with this big hammer, which says that the generalized Riemann hypothesis actually gives you a bound, that it makes the size of the prime effective, that it doesn't have to be too big. And that's basically the whole argument. The paper is like 6 pages long, and a good sort of light bedtime reading. Sort of thing. Okay, but maybe you'd like to know sort of unconditionally that you can certify something is knotted. And so this was a more recent result due to Mark Lackenby in 2016. So he proved that knottedness is also in NP, but this time unconditionally. So you don't need to make any assumptions. And this is a sort of much harder theorem. The paper's like 100 pages instead of 6. So the basic idea is there's a lot of very classical sort of three-manifold topology going into it. What he actually proves is that you can certify the Thurston norm of a class of manifolds that includes knot complements. I think anything may be irreducible with boundary union of tori. So if you want to certify knottedness, you just say, here's a Seifert surface, and I can check that it achieves the Thurston norm by this method. And so this requires, basically, how do you certify it? You produce a sutured hierarchy on the complement of a Seifert surface. You have to check that the hierarchy isn't too long. You have to check that you can decompose along surfaces in a reasonably fast way. And there's just a tremendous amount of work going into it, but in the end, everything can be checked in polynomial time. So that's Lackenby's argument. And I should say there was also an unconditional argument that was outlined by Ian Eagle in like 2003, but the details never appear. So I think this is sort of a maybe harder version of what he was proposing. One that definitely works because we have all the details now. Alright, so I'd like to say, well, what about other knots? Okay, if we can certify that something is or isn't the unknot. So in my mind, the next simplest class of knots are the torus knots. So torus knot or its complement certifiable in polynomial time. And so that's the main theorem of this talk. Is that actually, well, yes, yeah, so recognizing that something is a torus knot is in NP unconditionally, so you don't need to assume any generalizations of million-dollar problems. And in co-NP, assuming, just as Cooperberg did, the generalized Riemann hypothesis. Part of why I say this is not the final word on the problem is that, well, it'd be nice if someone were to prove this unconditionally, so something to think about while you're, for the rest of the talk, I guess. So that's the theorem. Sorry?
Just to check, so the input's a knot diagram.
The input is a knot diagram, right. So a knot diagram with n crossings. And we expect that you should be able to verify a certificate of either something being a torus knot or being not a torus knot in polynomial time in that number of crossings. Okay, and the other thing that we prove is that the same is true of the recognition problem for any specific torus knot. So you can answer the question, is this a torus knot? You can also answer the question, is it the 517 torus knot? Or at least, you know, check my answer if I hand you something to prove it.
So do you really need the knot diagram for the Cohen P side? If you go from a...
That's a good question. I think maybe not.
So without it, you're thinking of being given a triangle.
You're given a triangulation torus boundary, and you want to prove that it's not a torus knot.
Right. I think the triangulation is good enough, even if it has way fewer crossings. Okay. So before I start diving into the geometry, there's a warm-up exercise. Why are these two questions equivalent? Torus knot versus T 517 again. Why is that the same? Why are these supposed to be the same? So here's our proposition. Given a knot K, this part might require an actual diagram, so that's why I'm sort of hedging my claim here. But given K in diagram form, there is a polynomial time algorithm to return one of two things, either some pair of integers AB such that the Alexander polynomial of K equals the Alexander polynomial of the AB torus knot, and the signature of K is the same as the signature of the AB torus knot, or just return an empty set or something else if no such pair exists. And this is not such a hard proposition because we have polynomial time algorithms to compute the Alexander polynomial and to compute the signature of a knot. So you just have to run those, and then the question is, once you have this information, how do you determine what it is? And the proof is really just the fact that you have to check that that this pair of a polynomial and a signature that these determine actually that each torus knot distinguishes them from all the others. So the proof is that the AB torus knot has Alexander polynomial up to some power of t. So t to the AB minus 1 times t minus 1 over t to the A minus 1 dB minus 1. So we can pick out A minus 1 times B minus 1. This is the width of the Alexander polynomial. And we can also pick out AB as saying pi over AB is the least positive theta such that the Alexander polynomial has a zero at e to the I theta. Okay? So once you have this pair of integers, well, okay, this is not an integer, but you get a b out of it. Their difference is a plus b plus or minus 1, so now you have the product and the sum. And so this gives you, well, a b and a plus b, and you just solve the quadratic equation with these coefficients, and you get the pair a and b. Now, this is assuming that a and b are both positive, because the Alexander polynomial doesn't detect chirality. But then, once you know that it has the Alexander polynomial of some positive torus knot, then you can just check that, well, the signatures of positive torus knots are all positive if, you know, again, assuming a and b are both positive, and the signatures of the negative torus knots are both negative, so you can tell which of these it should be, and you just compute the signature of the say, the positive one and see if they agree or not. Okay? And maybe the other thing is that, just a remark, is that you have to actually compute this polynomial of degree AB, but AB is something like less than or equal to maybe 2n plus some constant. So this is computationally not a problem. And this is just really a general fact about the Alexander polynomial, that the degree is bounded by the crossing number.
So for the NP case, you do need the diagram.
For the NP case, you need the diagram. For the co-NP case, well, you'll see, we want to know that either it doesn't have the right Alexander polynomial in signature, so that, you know, we maybe need to do this computation. Which, given the triangulation, you can certainly find the Alexander polynomial. Maybe the signature is a bit trickier.
The Alexander polynomial might have a lot of...
Yeah, they might be too big as well.
Well, no.
Yeah. No? I mean, the crossing number could be exponential in the number of tetrahedra.
Yeah, but you compute the Alexander polynomial from, like, the triangulation, from a fundamental group.
Right.
That you compute the triangulation. So,
that's true.
So, so, you, so that you still...
So it'll be sparse.
Well, just, I mean, you're taking the determinant of a matrix size, yeah. Like the number of tetrahedra or something.
My intuition is it should be sparse, because the way to get the crossing number to blow up is to take lots of cables, and Alexander polynomial of cables. Okay. So anyway, so that's why these two questions are equivalent, and I'm going to sort of go back and forth a little between finding a torus knot generally and finding the specific torus knot. Okay, so the first proposition is, you know, I'll just prove the first half of the theorem. So a torus knot is in NP. And the main input to this, sort of geometrically, is a theorem of Simon from the early 70s that says the following. If you have a knot whose complement has an exterior annulus, then there aren't very many knots it could be. So if the exterior of K has an essential, meaning incompressible and not boundary parallel, then K knot could be one of three things. It could be a torus knot. It could be a cable. Or it could be a connected sum. And maybe I can draw pictures of each of these. So the picture for a torus knot and for a cable is really the same. You just say, here's the torus on which the knot sits. Maybe it wraps around something like this. I'm sort of making a mess of this picture, but there we go. So there's our torus knot, or possibly our cable. It sits on a torus, and the essential annulus is just sort of the rest of the torus. So you drill out a little neighborhood of the knot, and what's left in the middle is the essential annulus. And similarly, if we had a connected sum, here's K1, here's K2, and they're connected like this, then we just draw a sphere that realizes this connected sum. It intersects the knot in two places, and if we drill out little holes around those intersections, what we're left with is an annulus. So these are the only possible essential annuli you could have. And in each of these cases, we can say, what happens when we cut that annulus out of the exterior? Well, if it's a torus knot, we get a pair of two solid tori. Two times S1. If it's a cable, we get a solid torus from inside the neighborhood of the companion knot, and we get also the exterior of whatever the companion was. And if it was a connected sum, then we just get copies of the exterior of the summons. So all we have to do is say, let's provide an essential annulus and let's see what the complement is. So here's how we do this. So the certificate for torus, for being a torus knot, and I'm not going to answer the question of which one because we have that proposition over there. So in order to certify it, we first compute the Alexander polynomial and check that it is non-trivial. Okay, this isn't going to throw out any torus knots by mistake because there's the Alexander polynomial over there and it's clearly non-trivial. The second thing is we take the triangulation of the exterior of the knot, which you can build in something like n log n time with linearly many simplices, such that the triangulation on the boundary torus, which we'll just think of as this rectangle, has one vertex and two triangles. And so, for example, the paper of Hasselgerys and Pippinger tells you how to triangulate the knot complement in a pretty straightforward way. And then in Lackenby's paper about knottedness, he tells you that you can add linearly many tetrahedra so that the boundary torus gets simplified to just a pair of triangles. Essentially, you can sort of realize Fachnergs, which decrease the number of triangles by adding something like four tetrahedra at most per triangle you want to remove. And then once you have that, the thing which you need to be presented with is normal coordinates for an annulus. Sitting inside in the exterior. Okay, so this is the part where you have to actually just be handed something. And what you do then is you check that the boundary of this annulus, call it A, is non-zero in the homology of the boundary torus. This is what's going to tell you that it's essential. And then once you've done that, you decompose the complement of the annulus into, two components, which is a big part of Lackenby's proof of knottedness, is you have a suture hierarchy. How do you verify it? You need to be able to cut along surfaces efficiently, so you do that. And once you've done that, you just have to check, are these solid tori? And that's a solved problem. So. So I guess step five is verify certificates of components. And this is a theorem of Ivanov that the solid torus recognition problem is an NP, so such certificates exist and can be verified. And so that's what you need to do. The things you need to be handed are normal coordinates for an annulus, which is essential, and certificates that it's the two pieces of its complement are solid tori. And so
can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So I presume the normal coordinates, I mean, they're polynomial bit size, but maybe exponential and natural size.
Right.
So when you cut it open, I guess you can't like just use a triangulation or something, because then it might be complicated. Too many tensors to describe.
So, right. So
what is it like using handle structures or these kind of spines like Bruno's talk?
Yeah. So what Lakamy does is convert it into a handle structure, and then the idea is that it's not so bad trying to decompose this unless you have a whole bunch of parallel disks passing through one of the tetrahedra, and then there are just possibly exponentially many pieces. And so what he does is he says, well, we know if we sort of forget about what's in the middle there, we know what the complement looks like. And the thing in the middle that goes between all these parallel disks is just an I-bundle over some surface, and you can think really hard and just compute that efficiently. You build a handle structure for that and just glue it into place. So that's why this is actually doable.
So does this give another solution to a knot if you combine with solid torus?
The problem is that the annulus won't be essential. And so we use the balance.
What I mean is here you have some knot complements. When
right.
You cut along the annulus, you have two knot complements.
I see. But we need to know maybe that you can, that the annulus exists and the normal coordinates aren't too big, and so this requires input from Jacob and Tollefson. So,
I mean, five could be possibly good.
Okay, yeah.
I don't see why I want to say that, actually.
Well, I guess, that's a good question. All right, you have a triangulation of the solid torus.
Okay.
You know it's irreducible.
Right. Okay. So, to prove that this works, well, we just need to check that. So just we go through it step by step. In step one, we didn't throw out any torus knots. So in particular, because we threw out the unknot, we now know that the boundary is incompressible. And so once we know that the boundary is incompressible, that says that the annulus A essential if and only if its boundary components are not null homologous in the homology of boundary. So that actually verifies that it's essential once we know that it's an annulus. The next thing we need to do is know that the annulus isn't too big. So this, as I said, requires a theorem of Jacob and Tollefson, that essentially, if you have an essential annulus in your manifold, and you have some normal surface coordinates, they might be too big, but you can always find one which is a vertex surface. And so, again, by work of Hassel-Garius and Pippinger, the normal coordinates for this annulus are bounded by something like 7t, that's the number of coordinates if there are t tetrahedra, times 2 to the 7t, something like that. Something exponential so that it has polynomially many digits. So that means you can actually specify it and the certificate isn't too big, and you can actually then check that it's a certificate. And once we have this, we know it's essential. Let's see, it's not, we have to check that it's not boundary parallel, but I guess the one thing I'm missing is we maybe also compute the Alexander polynomial after we cut it out. Oh, right, sorry. If it was boundary parallel, right, we wouldn't have a parasolid tori. We'd still have the knot exterior as one piece and then S1, the solid torus together. So this is all you need to check that it's essential and that it actually cut the complement of a torus knot as expected. So anyway, this is the proof that it's actually an NP. That you can certify it and check in the polynomial time. I think there are other ways to do it. For example, if you think it might be the PQ torus knot, you can then compute PQ minus one surgery and PQ plus one surgery, both of which are Lens spaces, and you certify that they're Lens spaces by saying you have to compute some finite but not too big cover and check that it's the three sphere. And anyway, these are Lens space surgeries at distance two, and so the cyclic surgery theorem says that it has to be a torus knot exterior. So that's an alternate way to do it, but maybe just a corollary of doing it this way is that you also get that cable knot and composite knot as recognition problems are in NP as well. And the reason is, you say, I need to find an essential annulus and see what the complement looks like, and you just have to maybe check now that one or two pieces of the complement are non-trivial knot exteriors, which you can do by appealing to Lackenby to certify that their Thurston norm is non-zero. So I won't spend too much time on that.
Sorry, can I ask? I'm sorry if you've already said this. Why are you testing that the Alexander polynomial is not one?
Because if I know it's not one, then I know it's knotted, and so I know that the boundary torus is essential, and that helps me check that the annulus is not boundary parallel or anything, because I just have to check that its boundary components are essential in that torus. So the part that takes a little bit more work to figure out, and by more work I mean the generalized Riemann hypothesis, is the theorem that the other direction should be true. That torus knot recognition is in co-NP. We assume GRH. And just as a word of warning, what do I mean by this assumption? We need this, just as Cooperberg did, to claim that these short certificates exist. Once we exist, it's easy to check. You know, I can do a representation and you check that its image is non-abelian. So these are unconditionally quickly checkable certificates. It's just a matter of whether you actually have them. And so here's, let's say, proof strategy number one. And this is a partial success, but it fails because we just can't prove that it always exists. So proof strategy one is a theorem of Borda and Zeeshan. It says that actually, how do torus knot groups sort of stand out from other knot groups? They're the only ones that have non-trivial centers. So if the center of the knot group of K is not just the identity, then K is a torus knot. And moreover, if K is a torus knot, so if K equals, I guess they didn't maybe prove this, this is a little more, slightly more classical. If we have the AB torus knot, then the center is just generated by the element mu to the AB times lambda, where mu is a meridian and lambda is a longitude. If we look back at the picture over here of here's a torus knot sitting on a torus, well, the components of the complement are solid tori, And that curve, mu to the AB lambda, is this thing, it's just the core of this extra annulus, the thing we had to cut out. And so since it sits on the boundary of either solid torus, it's definitely central.
So you know, the idea would be, and the goal is give a representation I want to the exterior into, say, just like Cooperberg did, SL2 over some finite field, where we call this rho of that element, mu to the AB lambda, is not central in the image. If we do that, then we know it's not the AB torus knot. So we can be done.
If this works, you could also do cyber fiber spaces in Cauchy.
Is that right? Oh, because, well, the question is maybe how complicated is the element that generates the center.
Yes.
And here, if we have a knot diagram, you can just write that element down, and AB isn't too big compared to the crossing number.
So, I sacrifice the space of the boundary.
Maybe? Okay, so in order to make this pre-strategy work, we need to ask, you know, does such a representation exist? So what we need is really a representation pi 1 of the exterior into SL2C with, we call this rho of mu to the AB lambda, not central, where, you know, we found in polynomial time that the Alexander polynomial of K is the Alexander polynomial of the AB torus knot, and likewise for the signature. I mean, if no such AB exists, then it's definitely not a torus knot, so we're done. So we can just assume that it might actually be this torus knot, but not any of the others. And then we have to say, well, let's prove that this peripheral element isn't central. And then if this exists, we just repeat Cooperberg's argument, and we get SL2 FP representation with this property, where P is not too big. So that's what we need. And you know, the reason that this is sort of a failed attempt is that, in particular for say complicated satellite knots, I don't know that such a thing always exists. But here's a proposition. If K is hyperbolic, then such a row exists. So it's, you know, it's a partial success. Because most knots should be hyperbolic, so we can certify most of them. And the proof is very simple. Well, for example, if K is a hyperbolic knot, then there's definitely an injective representation into SL2C. Just take the holonomy representation, or the lift of the holonomy representation to SL2C. Okay, this is injective, that's why it's a holonomy representation. So the fact that it was hyperbolic meant that this peripheral element was not in the center of the knot group. That fact implies that its image is not in the center of the image. And that's it. So for hyperbolic knots, again assuming GRH, we do find such representations, at least one, and that's good enough.
Do you need to get some kind of algebraic or algebraic geometry condition statement of that? Because you need to push it down to the P.
Well, it's just that the set of all such representations is, again, a variety. You describe the SL2C character variety as some equations, and then, or the representation variety, and then you use the Rabinowitz trick to say that you can then describe the variety of points where this isn't central as sort of belonging to a higher variety, you know, higher maybe dimensional variety. You add some extra parameters, like if you want to show that some variable x is non-zero, then you add the equation tx equals 1.
I see. So to say that it doesn't commute with the generators, or that, one of the generators.
That's an algebraic condition, yeah.
Great.
And this is, you know, if you see a proof of like a Hilbert basis theorem, this is the same trick that goes there. So many sort of algebraic geometry, commutative algebra texts. Okay, so if we have a hyperbolic knot, we can certify then that it isn't a torus knot, conditional on G or H. Now the question is, the last bit of geometric input is, well, what if it's not hyperbolic, but it's also not a torus knot? So, the fact that if K is not a torus knot, then it is either hyperbolic or a satellite. So in order to certify that it isn't a torus knot, it actually now suffices to show, let's call this proposition prime, that the satellite recognition problem is an NP, assuming G or H. As long as we've already invoked it once, we might as well do it again. So I feel like that's maybe okay. Okay, and the reason this suffices is like I said, you know, if it's hyperbolic, you either give one of those certificates. Or it's a satellite, and you give some certificate of being a satellite. Okay. So here's the proof in principle that it is a satellite, or that if you have a satellite, you can certify it. So if it's a satellite, one way we can do this is just say, here's a non-trivial JSJ decomposition. One is enough, but somehow it doesn't cost you much extra to give all of them. These J tori are the things that realize the satellite operations, so you just need one to check that it's a satellite, and then you need to make sure it's not boundary parallel, because it could have just been like a trivial satellite, and that's not so interesting. So. By work of Mijatovic, the JSJ tori can be realized in normal surface form. So, the union of all the JSJ tori can be realized as a normal surface, disconnected potentially, but with, I think this is the right number, at most 2 to the something like 76 t squared, let's say 80 just to be safe. I guess it's the weight that's at most that. It's the number of elementary disks. So you can specify them in normal coordinates with roughly 80 t squared at most digits. And then once you have that, how do you certify that they're incompressible? You sort of read Lackenby's 100-page paper very carefully and realize that he already did that.
Well, you could certify the pieces as
yeah.
I will eventually.
Okay.
So how's Locke and me do this? He provides incompressibility certificates by basically, again, just saying, here's a sutured hierarchy.
Is it possible to certify the absence of compressing disks?
Compressing disks?
Mm-hmm. So like I have a single torus, which is not too big, I guess.
I suspect it's hard for the same reason that proving anything is in Cohen P tends to be hard, because you have to prove that there's no solution to some equations or conditions. So I don't know about that.
So is this incompressible sort of certificate somehow? I mean, it comes from the fact that you're essentially certifying that there's an norm, it's not a disk or something. Because in general, like for separating services, you don't have to have
Well,
or do you?
These are these are separating. I mean, he provides a sutured hierarchy just because if they're compressible, then the sutured manifold you get by cutting it open is not taut, and so there won't be a hierarchy. So, like, same as certifying the Thurston norm, so here's a hierarchy, you keep cutting it into smaller and smaller pieces, and you certify that at the end you have a bunch of three balls, and that's good enough. Okay, but the question is, how to check that at least one of these is not boundary parallel, because otherwise it's just you kept applying the trivial satellite operation and you didn't really have a satellite. So here's a picture, a schematic picture of what's going on with all these JS, J tori. Here's S3. Somewhere inside here we have our knot, K, which is presumably a satellite. And so if you have an incompressible, you don't have incompressible tori in S3 by the Alexander trick. So if you have an incompressible torus in the knot complement, it has to, the part of the torus that bounds a solid torus has to contain K. And then you can say if I have another incompressible torus, it also has to contain K. And so these end up just being sort of layered like this, going from K out to the complement of some simple knot at the end. So here are our tori. And S3 minus the union of these JSJ tori is the union of a couple pieces. There's the exterior of some knot K prime. Like I said, you sort of undo all the satellites. You start with your satellite, you pass to the companion knot, and so on until you hit the end. So it's the exterior of that companion union, if there's say n of these, well then we've got n pieces, let's call these mi, where each mi is actually the complement of a knot in the solid torus. Let's call this pi. That's p for pattern. Again, just looking at, say, the innermost torus here, like I said, this innermost torus bounds a solid torus with the knot on the inside, so what is T1 bound? It's just the complement of that innermost knot in the solid torus, and likewise sort of backing all the way out. So what we really need is to certify that one of these is not the sort of trivial thing with boundary parallel components. We need to certify that some MI is not a solid torus minus its core, or in other words, a torus times an interval. And this is where we have to, again, appeal to gauge theory somehow, to assert that maybe there's some representation of the fundamental group otherwise. And so that's what we do. So here's the proposition. If P sitting inside the solid torus is not isotopic to a core, in other words, 1 times point. Then there exists a representation, say rho from pi 1 of the exterior of P in the solid torus into SL2C with not abelian image. That's the main proposition. And then
could you we have two torus boundary components show that some element here doesn't commute with the generators there.
That some element here doesn't commute with the generators there. How do you check, right? Here's a presentation of a group, how do you check that some element doesn't commute with other elements?
Well, I mean, you're going to find a representation which separates them.
Sorry, what do you mean by separates? Oh.
Similar to what you were doing with your hyperbolic case.
Yeah.
Like the piece is hyperbolic, and you should be able to say that you're not commuting elements that are generators.
Yeah, so that is what I'm doing. Once you know that there is a representation with non-abelian image, that tells you that pi 1 isn't abelian, but this also gives you a way to find an FP point. So then to finish the proof, then the certificate of that some MI is not just a Thicken torus, is just a representation pi 1 to SL2 FP, which exists by, with non-abelian image, which exists by GRH.
MI is not.
Yeah. Is there a question?
MI is not equal.
MI is not. Yes, thank you. Okay. So how do I prove this theorem in the last couple minutes? So the proof of the proposition is here's a schematic or some sort of picture of what M might look like. So sitting on the boundary, we have a pair of distinguished curves. There's a meridian, which I'll call capital M. There's a longitude, which I'll call capital L. And when we cut out the knot P, we get sitting inside here some other torus boundary. Like this. And I'll call a meridian on the inside mu and a longitude on the inside lambda. So if that's the case, we know that I guess the homology of this MI is generated by two elements. One is there's a meridian on the outside, so capital M, and the other is the longitude. Maybe I've got this backwards. It's generated by the meridian on the inside and the longitude on the outside with, I guess, if we know the winding number of this pattern, then the meridian M on the outside is something like W times the class of mu, and the longitude on the inside is W times the class of capital L. So what we'll do is we'll just do lots and lots of Dane fillings of both boundary tori and get homology spheres and hope that maybe one of them has an interesting representation. You just need to find elements on the inside and the outside that generate H1 of M. And when we kill them, we get a homology sphere. So making sure I get my coefficients right. Let's fix integers, say R, which is non-zero, and some M. And then fill along the following two curves. Mu plus R lambda on the inside, and NM plus NRW squared plus 1 L on the outside. The point is that these generate the homology of this solid torus knot complement. So we get a homology sphere . Let's call this y sub rn. Now, two things could happen. One is that it could be the three sphere, and that's not so helpful. But if it's not the three sphere, then we apply a recent theorem, Hartwig of gauge theory, due to Zentner about a year or so ago, which says that any three sphere, and any homology three sphere other than S3 admits a non-abelian representation into SL2C. So there exists a non-abelian pi1 of y sub rn into SL2C. And then pi1 of this Dane-Field manifold is just a quotient of pi1 of the solid torus knot complement. So the composition of this is a representation with non-abelian image, and that would then be done. Okay, so in fact, for any R and N, if we get something other than this three sphere, we're done. So the question is then, how can we get only three spheres? So if we get S3 for both N equals 0 and N equals 1, so we fix the filling on the inside, N plus R lambda, and we choose two different fillings on the inside, then we get the core of y sub r n plus 1, which again by hypothesis was S3, admits an S3 surgery, which is non-trivial. Whereas the other S3 in this case was y sub rn. That's two different Dane fillings. So how do you have an S3 with a knot in it that gives you an S3 surgery? That has to be an unknot. So the core ends up being the unknot in S3.
You're using Gordon.
Sorry?
You're using Gordon.
That's right, I'm using Gordon and Lucci's theorem about non-trivial knots don't have S3 surgeries. So that says that this manifold that we're interested in, where we Dane fill along mu plus r lambda, is the complement of the unknot in S3. It's a solid torus. And this didn't depend on r, so it's true for all r. So what that says is the core. So the core of this mu plus r lambda filling has infinitely many solid torus surgeries. And now we have basically a complete understanding of which solid torus knots have solid torus surgeries due to Berge and Gabay. If you have any solid torus surgeries at all, then you have to be either a one-bridge braid or a torus knot. One-bridge braids all have two or fewer non-trivial surgeries, but we've got infinitely many. So that says that this core must be a torus knot. In S1 times E2. So actually, the manifold that we're trying to prove have non-trivial representations is S1 times E2 minus some torus knot, TAB. It doesn't have to be a torus knot in S3. One of the sort of longitudinal parameter could be 1. But in any case, and we just find explicit representations, SL2C with non-abelian image for all such torus knots, so for all pairs A and B. And that means that, again, assuming that this was actually a non-trivial knot in here, such a representation has to exist. And so that, that proves the, this proposition, which we needed to finish our certificate. So thanks for your attention. I'll stop here.
Checking boundary parallel, you can maybe shorten slightly by using Robert Harrawy's T2 cross I test. He basically tells you there's basically just, you just need to do 3 denture surgeries and then check you don't have a solid torus. And you still have to use generalized Riemann hypothesis to show it's not a solid torus what you have, but
right.
It might sort of simplify some of it.
Probably. I imagine the proof is probably the same going through Bergy by knots. So,
no.
I just didn't. Really?
Yeah. No.
Thanks. I didn't
because you just want to know in this case that piece is not T2 cross I.
Right.
Yeah.
Other questions? Well, I have one quick one.
Okay.
So the first half, are you anywhere close to getting some kind of a computable computer version running?
No, well, I haven't tried writing a single line of code at all, but my general assumption is that you can't beat Snappy or Regina or any of the other packages that are already out there. Or at least I can't beat them, so.
All right, well, I guess that's it. Let's thank our speaker again.